high school guidance initiatives. After that, we'll discuss the district governance project that we've been working on in the retreats and the consent agenda. Just have an open discussion on that. Any minutes, donations after that. Probably want to hold reports off and go right into the presentation so you don't stay here too late. So we're ready to go.
So thank you for having me. This was probably maybe 2 months ago.
Yeah.
At this point, we talked about me coming and just kind of presenting the guidance stuff around college admissions. And this is definitely an area that I'm passionate about and excited about. So when we were talking, I was happy to gather some data and present it to you guys and show you all the wonderful things that are going on in the school and then also areas that I think we could improve. So I'm just going to start off. You said the right one, Wayne?
Right one. Okay, this one?
Or at least it's not just me.
That always makes me feel better.
This is working. Just. Yep. No, it's in there.
Okay. Well, I think this one.
It's a PC.
I have slides memorized in my head, but that's not going to do you guys any good.
Do you want an extra copy, Lynn?
All right. Now we're done.
Try
Thank
again.
You. All right, so let's just, I'm going to start with just some of the basic data as far as college admissions, and this is specifically around last year's graduating class. So 87.5 went on to a four-year college, and this is attending college. 5.9% two-year college, and then it goes down to 2.4 with prep school, technical school, and then armed forces. I wouldn't be surprised if in years to come our number gradually goes down, because when I start to look at other districts, and some of the districts who have a high graduation rate, high average SAT scores, things like that, their numbers for students attending college right after high school are gradually declining. And guidance directors, we attribute that to more and more students are doing gap years, so that they're not going to fall into, you know, the 2 and 4 year school. So I actually think that's a wonderful thing. If our numbers do slightly go down, that's not alarming for me. It's just that as long as they're doing something productive and in a gap year program or doing something meaningful, even if it's not a specific program, but something meaningful, more and more colleges are looking at that. Princeton is just one example where they're actually encouraging students to go do a gap year program before starting their freshman year. So it will be interesting to see if that continues on.
So a gap year, I see a prep school up, that's something different.
Something totally different. So there are many, many gap year programs out there. They often involve traveling, community service with an organized group, and they're going off and doing these wonderful, amazing things, and they're coming back just learning so much about themselves. So when they go into college, they are ready, they're focused, and I think there's a higher rate of students graduating within 4 years for those students who are doing gap year programs.
I just had a quick question.
Yeah.
Is there a way that you could account for that going forward? So when you're doing the survey of graduating seniors, so that we could capture that data?
Yes.
Great.
So at the end of the year for seniors, all of them have to complete a senior exit survey for guidance. That tells us which colleges they've applied to, where they got accepted, denied, waitlisted, where they're attending school, so we know where to send their transcripts. And then we ask a whole bunch of other questions, like did they do SAT prep? Did they have a college, private college counselor outside of here? And so we will know from that survey if they did a gap year program.
I just have another, sorry, keep interrupting you. So we're kind of going through this right now. And
we're only
one of the
first
things.
But there's three of us here who are going through this.
One of the things I've noticed is, and, you know, I guess I don't disagree with it, is a lot of the schools aren't putting as much emphasis on the SAT, and you see that continuing to get momentum.
more and more schools are looking at test optional. So the students are still taking the SATs, ACTs. ACTs is definitely increasing as far as our students nationwide. There's more students taking ACT versus SAT, but more and more colleges are going test optional. I don't know what the exact number is, but it's a significant amount, which is really helpful to our students because I'd say most of the tiers that I have early in the fall are because of their low standardized test scores and just being nervous with that. But there's options out there.
Yes.
So some of the four-year academies have sort of a prep school, and some of our students may use that route. So it's sort of a gap year. It's a prep year at a different type of military. Would that data fall into the two-year or
four-year?
Are
you talking about the post-grad programs?
If they don't get into Annapolis or West Point, the academy, they can go into a program that's effectively a gap year, a prep year at another institution. I'm just sort of wondering, does that end up in the two-year or four-year data right now?
Like a transfer, you mean?
I don't
know. They get accepted.
Off the top of my head of like where that would fall. That's a good question.
And then I think just a lot of the universities in line with that are doing, they're doing like January acceptances, right? And they're basically offering the students a first semester gap experience,
right?
I guess, that you still get to pay for. But it just gives them the opportunity maybe to, you know, admit more students. They make more money. They can admit more students. But it's a great program. I think they're good programs for students.
There's
and
a lot
the matriculation.
Of what will be interesting is if there's more and more students where that's happening too, because this is data. And so sometimes a student won't tell us that they're a January admin on their exit survey. And so we kind of, just as counselors, have to be looking at that and just the information that students are telling us.
The other thing is, I've heard is, and it's more of it motivated for financial reasons, is a lot of families look at the two-year option, and you know, the two-year schools are a lot better than they were. So is that up, or is that kind of, do you see that?
It's pretty consistent, just from the past few years, that's the data that I was looking at, but it is something that our students are considering, and we're talking to the students all the time about the financial benefits of.
And then just transfer into a four-year.
Mm-hmm.
Tough first slide.
All right, so again, this is based off of the senior survey, so students who are self-reported. So they are attending 124 different colleges, and this is just last year's class. Accepted to a lot more schools than that, but actually attending 124 different colleges. 72% stay in New England. Not a surprise in the sense that we have so many wonderful schools here, so that's not really a surprise. 51% stay in Massachusetts. I did find the 51% interesting, but I'd be curious to compare that to other districts. 21% of them attend state schools, and there's an increase as far as the expectations or the criteria to get into state schools now. It's none. They're not safety schools anymore. Getting into UMass Amherst is not easy for a good portion of our students, and so it's interesting that's 21% are attending state schools. I think that's a wonderful thing. I think that we have a lot of wonderful state schools, and kids should be considering those. I separated New York more just because when we're talking to students, New England, New York, all together, but they are obviously separate, but just because when we're talking with students, a lot of them lump New York into New England. So 9% are going to New York schools, and then 19% are outside of there, which is 20%, almost 20%. And I'd like to kind of look at that as the years go on, just helping students kind of expand the options. There are so many wonderful schools out there, and that's part of my job working with the counselors to kind of expand that so they know about the schools outside of New England. And then 66% said they are attending their first choice college. that's what they're reporting. I will say that on one aspect, that's good news. That, you know, we have a large percentage of the students getting into their first choice school. On the flip side, I don't really know how the students are viewing when we're asking the question if they are attending their first choice school. If they are basing that first choice off of where they got accepted, and it's the first choice out of those that group of schools, or is it first choice based off of when they started the admissions process? So that's a little bit hard for us to tell, but still interesting information that 66 said that they're going to their first choice.
Can I ask just a really quick question on the last one? The 21%, is that 21% of the 51% or 21% of the whole?
The whole.
Thank you.
Yep. All right, so this is the part that I'm always looking at the data. So this is the 3-year comparison as far as how many applications students are submitting, the number of colleges, percent, the number accepted, early decision versus early action. I've been doing this for 15 years, and I feel like every year more and more students are applying to more schools, and the deadlines are getting earlier and earlier. Especially those November 1st and November 15th, all of the counselors were quite stressed this weekend getting everything out and making sure everything is there on time. So as you can see, the number of applications have increased over the years. There was a slight dip last year, but I think that may be due to a lower number of students in last year's class, so that is kind of what I would expect. Number of colleges they're applying to, so when I kind of compare these two, so the number of applications increased, but the number of colleges they're applying to didn't increase significantly, which means that there are more students applying to the same schools, which makes it a little bit more challenging for our students. So again, that kind of goes back to what I was saying before, that I would like to find a way to kind of expand where students are applying, because I think that's just really going to help them. Number accepted, to me, I'm not worried that there was a dip in the number accepted. I'm encouraging students to, as long as their parents can afford it and the parents are on board with it, to apply to more schools and have reaches. With reaches, there's a chance they're not going to get accepted, but it's always worth trying. So if there's a school that they want to go to and maybe they don't fit the, you know, the typical profile, it's a reach for them. They might get in, they might not, but that's where some of the dip might come from. So that doesn't worry me so much. A few more students applying early decision. So for those of you who don't know, that's the binding decision. So they're signing an agreement saying that if they get accepted, this is where they're attending. And then the early action is not a surprise whatsoever. Well over 80% of our students are applying to at least one school early action. The deadlines are creeping up, getting earlier and earlier. I did hear on the news, it was probably a month ago, that they're discussing the possibility of there's this application that could start freshman year. When I saw that, I got a little bit of anxiety of how this would work. It will be interesting to see if that gets rolled out.
Financially
that will significantly
motivated.
Change my job.
Yeah.
So I know my kids would not want me to be on their case starting freshman year, but the one interesting thing about early decision, I think, is that, yeah, you really, as you look at the acceptance rates, the colleges, I think, this year even more than last year, are really pushing their early decision and saying, you know, you want to get into Northwestern, we have a 40% acceptance rates early decision and a 16% regular. Every college was like that, trying to really push the ones that have the early decision were just really trying to push that. Whereas I think the early action is really much more of a way for them to distribute their workload than anything else.
Yep.
There's really not as much of a difference, but I was sort of struck by how much they were pushing it. And I think it's really, I guess I'm sort of not surprised, but that's really low. But I think it's very hard for most students to like know where they want to be committed to up front.
Right, and you know what we're telling students is that they need to be 100% positive this is where they want to go. Because
yeah.
The only way to get out of it is for financial reasons, and you have to prove that you can't pay for it.
Right.
And so for some of our families, that might be difficult to prove. So I think that's maybe where some of the low numbers are
but
coming
it, but
from
it means
first.
That on the other side of that, the more they push that, the more you're going to see the number of accepted sort of go down in the
right.
overall because
right.
it's much harder
yeah.
to get in.
Yeah. So this, I just put this slide here, just as, these are things that colleges are considering when they're reviewing applicants. And so there are things that are in our control as a school, there are things that are not in our control. Things that are not in our control, if a school is looking to have a more diverse campus, we can't control. That's out of our control. If they're looking for an oboe player, if they're looking for a male tennis player, we can't control any of those things. But there are things that I think that we can have an influence on, and that is mostly our academics, how we're preparing our students, the classes that we are providing, the rigor of our education, also how we are just informing our students about the college admissions process and what we're doing as guidance counselors. So one of the things that I look at is the SAT scores. And, you know, just to your point earlier, that more colleges are going test optional, but there are lots of colleges that are still looking at the SATs. And so we need to pay attention to this. In general, if you look at the last 3 years, we are, well, the state average was from last year. So in just all three categories, we are at least 30 points or more higher than the state average, which is great for our school. And they're pretty consistent over the last few years. The averages haven't changed all that drastically. But when I came here, this is my third year here, I was kind of in my head just wondering, why are our SAT scores where they are? And there's so many different reasons, but there was something that was sitting with me as far as our college acceptances, SAT scores, and coming from a school that has a higher average of SAT scores. So we decided to take a look at 18 different school districts, including Reading. And this is where we kind of fall. So, you know, I put it with the combined average SAT scores with median home sales. Now, we all know that median home sales doesn't necessarily mean that if you live in a $700,000 house that you're going to have higher SAT scores. But it was helpful for me as far as just kind of looking at where we stand as far as kind of average communities. Where do our students compare to others? So if you look at this shaded area, I feel like this is where we really want to focus, is in that shaded area. And so in that shaded area, we're right in the middle, right? So that's great. You know, our students are doing well on the SAT scores. We're right in the average. But my question is, why aren't we where some of those, why aren't we a little bit higher where some of those other districts, which are in the same category that we are in as far as medium home sales, why aren't we there? Now, there's so many different reasons that that could be, and that's a much bigger discussion and probably we'll have at another time. But I feel like we're good. Let's be great. And so let's take a look at the data as far as we can be looking at the data that College Board, we can be paying for data for College Board to send us information about how our students do on each section of the SATs. We can be checking over where our curriculum lies with that, and those are things that we are talking about and hoping to do soon. But I do feel like we're good. Well, let's be great. All right, so there's SATs, there's APs. So according to this chart, the information that I gathered that over the last few years, the number of exams have increased. So that's not just the number of students. The total number here, the second one, is the total number of students taking AP exams. But the top number could be a student taking 4 exams or 6 exams. But both of them have increased. The third level says the number of AP scores that are 3 or higher. In general, for the students to receive credit at the college level, they want a 3 or higher. And every school and every department within the school might have different criteria, but in general, we would love to see them get a 3 or higher. Now, there's benefits for the college when they get to college and they get college credit for it. There's the benefit for the students. But on the flip side, I feel like, and this is just something that I'm talking about with the Middlesex guidance directors, more and more students are taking AP exams for admissions purposes, not just for credit. But there's benefits on both sides. Now, where we stand compared to many other districts, we offer 13 AP courses, which is a good number. What I have found, and this is something that Mr. Bacher and I have talked about just from us coming from different districts, we are very heavy in the math and science AP courses, and what we'd like to do is kind of expand that. So students have more options to take AP courses both junior and senior year and spread it out. There are students who can take two AP courses. I think it's generally students who are at that highest, the high level, are usually taking one or two AP courses junior year, and then they're taking three, four, five senior year. The problem with that is, well, let's talk about the benefits first. Benefits are that they're taking these courses, if they do well in the exams, then they get college credit for many schools, not all schools, but many schools. The disadvantage from the admissions piece, which is why many students take AP exams, they don't have the first quarter grades, they don't have exam grades. And so what we'd like to see is kind of expanding the offerings that we have for AP courses and potentially increasing the number of students who are taking them. With that in mind, we need to be kind of careful, and you kind of have to weigh out the pros and cons. There's benefits to increasing the number of AP courses that we offer. There are some students who will just have, you know, a well-balanced life and they know how to manage it. And there's the other students on the other end who just jump right in and take all the AP courses because they think that's what they need to do. There are many districts that are fighting the social-emotional piece and the stress of these higher level kids. I'd say right now when we're looking at the data as far as our kids who are really struggling socially and emotionally, it's not all our top level kids. I'd say that there's a handful, but it's not the overwhelming number that we have. And so when we're considering expanding our options, we are having the discussion of just making sure that it's manageable and we're not asking students to do something that's kind of too stressful and overwhelming.
So maybe this, this belongs a little bit later, but I think that that also speaks to I have two things. That, you know, so some students may want to specialize, and so how do we help them do that? So I think maybe we can have a little bit more discussion, and maybe that's coming up. But I also just would like to say, I think it's fabulous to want to enhance what we offer, if we can afford to do that. I believe somebody taking like AP psychology, so like we don't offer it, right? So they're doing AP psychology virtually this year. So, but I want us also to look at the demographics in the classes and make sure that we're doing what we can do, especially, I'm especially concerned in the STEM stuff. People pretty much know that, but you know that we've got the a good mix gender-wise or just demographically in those higher level classes. So I think that's another piece of that puzzle.
So you mentioned virtual AP courses, so could you, is that part of the slide presentation?
It's not, but I can talk about it.
Okay.
So we have a contract with VHS, and so there's a whole variety of different courses that students can take, and AP courses are one of them. So it's pretty much everything that we offer here in school, but there's also other courses. So AP Psych is one that I want to say when we're, I think we're at seven students who are taking AP Psych. Six or seven students. Last year we had one. I think she must have liked it, and then word got out, and now we have more. There's AP Government, Economics. There's a whole variety of different options that they can take. It does, you know, there is a fee that goes with the AP courses. So it's an option to help us out.
So do we do any, this is a ways back when I was an administrator in the Danvers Public Schools, we did a AP chorus, choral, I guess, and we didn't have enough students in Danvers, so we collaborated with Beverly. I don't know if that's something to think about, if that's feasible, but.
So you offered a course, but there wasn't enough students to take it, so there were students from Beverly, or
we had
was it a VHS kind of?
No, it was not done through. It was an online, so to speak, so they videotaped the course, and it had to be, you know, it was live, so it was sort of like a FaceTime, Google Hangout type of thing, you know, so I guess what I'm saying, it wasn't so much there weren't enough students, it just didn't warrant, you know, a teacher dedicated to four students. So they were able to, I can't remember exact numbers, but Beverly had a strong music program as well, and, you know, I'm not sure if they're still doing it, but it'd be something to look into that, you know, something in the arts that could be an AP, and I know there's an AP test for it.
I will say that we're looking at options and always open to ideas, so that's something that we can look into.
Yeah, might be worthwhile.
Yes.
Thanks. I have a question about the last line on this graph, where the percentage of students with scores of 3 or higher is declining a little bit, but at the same time, the number of students taking the test, or the number of tests taking, is increasing. So I'm trying to figure out what that means. Is it a good thing because more kids are accessing AP who maybe aren't going to score a 3, 4, or 5, but they're having that experience of a very rigorous course that will mimic what college coursework might be like? Or are you concerned, is it an area that needs to be looked at? How should I make sense of those two lines?
A little bit of both?
Yeah. So you've got a couple things going on. We do have a new course, an AP Comp Sci, with a newer teacher, so some of those scores are tied into the first couple of years, that learning curve. But I think you're certainly seeing an increase in the number of students who are kind of challenging up. And in many districts, that's kind of a philosophy, is having kids really stretch, become exposed to the AP course with the understanding that they're becoming more and more prepared for college, even if the score ends up being a little bit lower. So we're having discussions around that philosophy.
Yeah, just to follow up, I could really see that. You certainly don't want a child struggling, but if a kid really challenged themselves and had a great experience and they scored 2 on the test, but it was a good experience, there could really be value in that. I can see that.
And we are also, I mean, this is just the overall numbers the College Board is giving us, but one of the things that we are looking at is the each individual subjects with the department heads, which is helpful, too, because we have the data how many 5s, 4s, 3s, 2s, 1s, and that's what department heads are looking at. So this kind of leads into kind of going back with the number of students who score 3 or higher. So College Board ranks students as far as, well, I don't know if ranks is the, I give them a designation or an honor. So there's AP scholars, and those are students who scored 3 or higher on 3 or more exams. And then it goes a step up for AP scholars with honors, that they have to score 3.25 on all exams taken and scored 3 or higher on 4+ exams. And then it just goes up with each level. I will say the numbers are not a surprise. I would love to see higher numbers as we move forward and we increase numbers in AP classes and the offerings. I wouldn't be surprised if our numbers go up in some of these things, because when you have more classes for students to take, right now we're heavy in math and science, but what about all those other students who may not be, you know, their strengths might not be math and science, but they might be in other areas. So when we start offering those classes, then you're going to see more 3s and things like that.
Can I just add, is this the year of the AP exam or the students' year, like the seniors, which
so
is that?
So the year of the AP exam. So it's a combined junior and senior.
Right.
Yep.
Okay.
Usually to get these for Reading, it's senior year, to get these designations.
Right.
Yep. You can get them in junior year if we offer more classes then.
Or kids have more access to
or
those classes earlier.
Yep. It's nice to know where you fit.
Okay,
you're
sorry.
All right. So I just listed here just a few things as far as what now, specifically for the guidance office. So one of the things that, and this is not specific to standardized test scores, but it's just different things that we're trying in the guidance department to improve things. So the first is this year we've kind of restructured how we're doing the developmental guidance program, and we're meeting with our own students. So in the past, we used to go into an English class, and we might cover the career piece, but we would be talking to, you know, if I was doing it, I might have 4 students on my caseload, and I might have 20 students on someone else's caseload. Now we're doing it is that we are pulling them out and we're meeting with our own students. So the nice part about that is that it helps us have more contact with our own students. The more we get to know our own students, the better advice that we can give them as far as course selection and college planning later on. And also the social emotional piece. So although this is presentation is very focused on the college admissions piece, it's really only 50% of our job. The other 50% is the social emotional piece. So the more contact we have, the more support we can be providing. That's what we're doing this year. I'm keeping my fingers crossed that we have the option of a different schedule next year or in a few years, because what I would love to see is guidance counselors teaching classes for just quarters, where we are, you know, first semester we are working with the seniors and doing the whole college process with them. Second quarter could be working with freshmen as far as, you know, getting involved in activities and goal setting and things like that, and so forth with juniors and seniors. What I don't want to happen is that we are providing more stress, putting more stress on the students. So the only way to really do that is to, if there's a space in the schedule, so things would have to change. So that's just something that we are looking at. No guarantees on that one.
What's the ratio? How many counselors do we have? How many students are under your care?
So we have 6 guidance counselors. I have a reduced caseload by 50%. So I have about 120. The rest of the counselors have somewhere around 240, give or take.
In each grade?
Total.
Right.
Yeah.
Yeah,
so
that's
they work 9 through 12.
Exactly,
yeah.
Okay. And then in an ideal situation, if you're with us for a long time, the students that you have in ninth grade, you follow through the senior year.
Who's the senior year? No, they're stuck with me. And I'm not going anywhere. The next bullet is just about one of the things that Mr. Bacher and I are used to is coming from a system where the counselors meet with every student around course selection. And I just think that is so valuable.
Mm-hmm.
Starting with freshman year, if we can meet with every single student and kind of map out their plans for the next few years, and it only takes a few minutes to do this, but those few minutes that we spend with them really make a difference as far as it's setting them up so they know what they need to take if they are thinking about college, encouraging them to kind of step it up a little bit in some courses if they're doing really well. We're explaining the GPA, and I just see such value. So we are starting to do that this year.
Just a little plug for that. I think that kids often hear that kind of advice so much better from not a parent.
Yes.
So I think that's real value. You know, a parent
can say the same things, though.
Yeah, a parent could give all of that advice and you don't know what you're talking about, but if a guidance counselor says it, they'll change everything. So
that's
I think that's
why
really
I love
important.
My job. They listen to me. Now, if I can only get my own kids.
That must be nice.
As mentioned before, we're looking into the possibility of increasing the AP options. One of the things that the English department head and I have been talking about is the college essay. So right now, there are the CP and SCP classes senior year are covering the college essay. It's not offered to everyone. We are looking into the possibility of figuring out a way that we can do that for everyone. There are some school districts where they offer classes on essay writing specific to the college essay, and there are other high schools that it's just built right into their English curriculum. I want to make sure that our students are not at a disadvantage compared to other districts.
So that, I guess my experience, though, has been with my 4 boys is that it's certainly been something that's been part of the English class and the classes that they took. It might not have been as structured, but they all had the opportunity, you know, every open house that we went to when the kids were in senior year, the teachers talked about, you know, we're going to spend some time on the essays. I guess the thing is it's not a mandatory thing. But I just also feel like these essays that the kids have to write, you can't squeeze them out of them. They have to be ready to write it.
Mm-hmm.
So I feel sort of both ways. It was great to have the teachers available to support the teachers. All when the kids had their essays ready, the English teachers were all definitely there to proof them and gave some feedback. But I just think that, you know, if you try to force these essays, they stink. You have to rewrite them.
Yeah.
So when they're ready.
Yeah.
So
there's a good chance that many will have to rewrite because you're absolutely
right.
If they're not ready to write, they're not going to. They're just going to do it for a homework assignment and turn it in and get the grade and then I'm done. But they have to, you know, they want to be writing something that's really meaningful, that they're ready, that this is what they're presenting to the college. I think in the English class, giving students the information of how to write a college essay, things to think about, things to avoid, that's all helpful. And then having the availability, if they are ready, that the English teacher's there to cover.
I guess I almost think like the prompts, you know, giving them experience with the prompts and making them do like an ungraded exercise, like it's going to take the next 15 minutes to just write on that prompt, just write on it. Like that,
yeah,
that might really help get their creative juices, but I think it's great. I totally appreciate the partnership. I just, after 4 years of this, I'm not sure what the right partnership is. It was different for all of my boys. All
right.
Different teachers,
yeah.
All different classes.
Yeah.
Linda could probably say the same thing.
Yeah.
Thank goodness I just finished the last one.
You finished
I actually was thinking that thing. Thank goodness I finished all three. And they were very well prepared and had wonderful support from the guidance. I guess I just want to reinforce what you've voiced a concern that you don't want to raise the stress level and you don't want to make it earlier, that I would very much endorse that, because I think that I'd hate to see a scenario where we start focusing on college acceptance like we might standardize tests. I don't want our curriculum to start focusing on preparing for the test, preparing for the essays. I think, like Mrs. Webb was saying, there are different ways to do that that might be fun even. I mean, my daughter's essay ended up very fun. We just, you know, she took it and ran, and that was a great experience for her, I think. And the reaction to it was too. So having experience in doing prompts like the exams, but from meaningful places for them, as opposed to we're going to be practicing for your college entrance, because the competition's already there, and they're already stressed, and that just can run, that can interfere with, like you were saying, that can interfere with their performance. So that's just my caution. Same with when I was hearing you talk about raising the scores of the SATs. I hate to put more pressure on test scores and kids that just might not excel at tests where they might excel at something else.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Regarding the SATs, though, I don't, in my mind, maybe I didn't communicate this, and thing, but I am not looking at it as that we have to talk more about the SATs and structure the lessons to say this is going to be on the test and have it be in their face. But from an administrative point of view and department heads, if we are looking at the data that College Board can provide to us as far as how our students do on certain questions, it might be something that, hey, we cover this at this time, or maybe we're not doing this as much as we should, and it doesn't even have to be mentioned to the students.
Yeah.
You know, it's just kind of looking at our curriculum.
Yeah, I would echo that, and we'll get to it in a minute, but I think what we've noticed in the first couple of years that Lynn and I have been here is just there isn't a real intentional look at the data in general, which in some cases, you know, just disaggregate the MCAS data, disaggregate the SAT data. If upon that further analysis, it's clear there are certain standards that maybe don't make a whole lot of sense in terms of college readiness, but are really emphasized on a given year on an MCAS or an SAT, at least we know that and are making the conscious decision to kind of continue business as usual. But in a couple of cases, you know, just highlighting a certain area that may not be in a certain grade level or in a certain course really has an impact without, you know, taxing the stress level too much. I think that's what we're trying to do, is just be a little more intentional as we look at the data and make some decisions.
Can you just, yeah, still come back. Go come back.
Do we ever have, is it feasible to have discussion with college admissions offices? Does that happen? I only say that my nephew.
Specifically about SATs, or
just
in general?
What they're looking for, what, like,
yes,
particularly in the essays, what they're looking for, the demographics of the students that they're, you know, interested. I know I've had some interesting conversations with my nephew, who was a admissions officer at Penn, and some funny stories too. But you know, it was interesting to hear what they were looking for in Ivy League school. I was kind of taken back by some of the things they really wanted to see, but I don't know if they...
So from a guidance counselor point of view, there's a few things that we're doing. We're trying to get out and visit as many colleges as we can. In addition, we have about between 40 and 50 colleges every year that come visit our guidance office. So student, they're meeting with seniors. So they might meet with a group of students, but they're also meeting with us individually either before or after. So we can ask any question that we want. So we are asking those types of questions of what they're looking for in an applicant. We're asking questions about APs, essays, all those different things that we're just trying to gather more information about. We just had our college fair where there was 145 colleges that came, and we were estimating somewhere around 500-600 students came. But we provide a nice dinner for them, and that's when we just take the opportunity to go around, mingle with them, and ask them questions. And I got a lot of great ideas about how like we can make things better. And so we're doing those types of things, and we're going to continue to do that. Kind of jumping down to the last bullet, one of the things that I've been tossing up, and it's not definite, and I talked to a few colleges at the college fair who said that they would be willing to do it. More and more colleges are trying to find ways to get college admissions representatives on their campus, because once they're on campus, they're going to remember our school, they're going to remember our students. And they're having panel discussions. So there's some schools that do it for parents and students at the same time. There are other schools that do it for just students during the day. There's a whole variety of different ways that we can do it. But they're giving the information to the students and parents. So kind of similar to what you were saying, that they might listen to a guidance counselor more than a parent. Sometimes they're going to listen to the admissions person more than they're going to listen to a guidance counselor and more than a parent. So it's something that we are tossing up the idea of providing that.
I think that's important because, I mean, once again, there's this flurry of we got to visit all these campuses, and frankly, not everybody has the means to get on a plane and go somewhere or drive somewhere. So the more we can get those people here, it gets a lot more people involved.
That's my goal. Okay. So I think that I covered everything. Well, I jumped to the last bullet, so if we kind of go back up, it's just looking at the data. So the second to last one is reviewing data gathered from other districts regarding their college acceptances and just seeing where their students, and not just, I'd like to see specifically, like, where are their top 10 students as far as highest GPA. Like, I'd be curious to, like, where we compare to other districts. It's very easy for us to pull up online at the school profile or just on their website where students are getting in general, but we don't know if it's one student getting into, you know, five Ivy League schools or was it five different students. So I'd like to really look at that data more in depth, and that's something that we've talked about doing. So with that, that's the end of my portion of it.
Thank you.
Leads into Mr. Bacher, unless you guys have any more questions.
Yes. I have a question. You guys are already doing so much, and you have only so many hours in a day. Do you have a bandwidth for doing this additional data? Is this something that other staff can be helping with, or what?
As far as looking at the data for other schools, that's pretty easy for me to get. As far as looking at the data regarding SATs, that's going to have to be a bigger group of people kind of looking at that. Is that what you're talking about?
Yes, yeah. I'm just wondering how you fit in everything that you do. I'm so in awe, and having benefited from it for so many years, I'm just wondering how you fit it in and if you have a strategy in mind and
strategy in mind, but we will figure it out.
Lot of it comes down to the data management software that you have. So some of the student management software in the district that Dr. Doherty are looking at does assist greatly in kind of streamlining that work. And then obviously College Board, the different options that they offer at a price just to help disaggregate some of that data. And then as soon as it, we have a new position that's created at the district level.
Right, so
principals and guidance directors too.
there's two other pieces to this. One is that we do have that data analyst that we're in the process of hiring that's going to play a big role in these types of activities throughout the district. But then these are also perfect activities that are that are discussed during the PLC time. Mm-hmm. Is taking a look at the data. All of the staff that would be affected by that are looking at that data. And using a protocol to assess where we're going to go with it.
Yes. This is like our third or fourth meeting where we talk about this, so I think it's good that we put this emphasis and resource. I think it's just so important because in order for the PLC to be effective, the data has to be crunched to a point and be in a format that it's informative,
right,
that it can inform decision, that you can work with the data, you know, to come to conclusions, to ferret it out. And I think that's really, really important. So it requires that resource up front even to help support the PLC. I just think it's good that we're, you know, starting to move forward on that. It's just like I'm in awe almost every meeting we come to about where we really need the data. There's so much data if we're going to make a change.
Yeah, I was struck by how little data analysis we really do at the high school. But to me, it's very encouraging because in spite of that intentional look, you know, the kids are doing very well, teachers are having great success. So I think just in kind of taking a scalpel-like approach and looking at where do we apply some resources, time,
mm-hmm.
By disaggregating that data,
right,
I think we're going to see huge, huge impact.
Right.
Exciting.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Williams. Good evening, everybody. So again, kind of taking a look at some of the data that we've talked about in my first year, last year, talking to teachers, parents, students, and really trying to see, you know, where can we spend some additional time and continue the good work that's going on, but also make some adjustments to really support, you know, additional teaching and learning. A couple of things that kind of surfaced, and we try to complement the district goals. Size of that font, really trying to tie in the common measures that tie in with the evaluation system. So instead of adding on to already busy and full plates, we try to tie into the mid-year exams and the final exams as a real important measure to just make sure that that things are going well, that courses are aligned, and again, using the PLC time, really have teachers talk to one another and calibrate their work, both instructionally and their assessments. The second area we also looked at was just the curriculum frameworks. So we're still, you know, in a different range depending on the course, depending on the discipline. And that PLC time, again, has been a real helpful vehicle to just do kind of a gap analysis in certain places to make sure that you'll have a very different experience from teacher to teacher, but that students do have similar experiences both within a course and a level, but across levels, so that it's not so different that kids aren't finding, you know, success at each of those levels in terms of college readiness. And then the other thing we're looking at this year at the district level, but specifically at the high school level, is just making sure that our instructional practices are really research-based. We're really taking a good look at using our district curriculum accommodation plan and using that also during our PLC time. It's also a recurring agenda item on our department head meetings, just to talk about where our teachers are and their, you know, varying comforts with using those different accommodations. Certain teachers have a range of kind of tricks in their tool bag, and others are, you know, benefiting from that conversation and dialogue and being able to try new things that meet students where they are and tie in with kind of the tier one interventions for the kids that are having some difficulty before they need to be referred either to 504 or to an IEP. Those students are benefiting just from that rich discussion around research-based instruction. And then we're continuing on kind of in the same vein, the work that had been begun last year in the mass tiered system of supports. So really trying to improve the use of data so that we're being less reactive to students who are struggling and more proactive. And so some of that is better utilizing the data resources that exist at the state level, using a product called Edwin that really identifies several indicators that indicate students who maybe had struggled. It's a combination of attendance data, students' retention data, keeping a pace with graduation requirements, and then we meet in a team which consists largely by department heads, also our school psychologist, and the administration, just to talk about what we're seeing in terms of trends and patterns. But to your point, Ms. Doxer, we want to make sure we're not overemphasizing one area with that bandwidth and maybe the wrong area. So we're having those conversations on a pretty regular basis. And then lastly, just again, emphasizing the PLC work. So that's really been the vehicle, at least once a month, where we're trying to make sure that we stay course with curriculum work, also the assessments, and then most recently looking at the DCAP and how that's going. Specific goals at the high school, so from those conversations with teachers, with parents, with students, with administration, there were really five or six areas that kind of surfaced the most as being places to continue to develop, places of concern. The first one actually tied into some work that had been begun before I came, which was around core values. And folks just felt as though we really need to become clear on what's important to us at the high school. And that goes across the different stakeholders. So towards the end of last year, several different meetings, both with students and with the teachers, we did talk about what really the school believes in, what are really going to be those guiding principles that will help to shape and influence all our decision making and just kind of keep us centered on the right things in terms of time, in terms of resources. So we're just finishing that work up in the first couple of meetings after school and the first weeks of school. Now the work really will begin around, okay, we have four different words, we have four different ideas and values. How is that going to be used? How are we going to implement that day to day around a program of studies, our graduation requirements, just our expectations for one another, for the students, and making sure that it's not just something that looks nice on letterhead or on the wall, but is actually a living and breathing resource. The second thing that really came up as a key issue, and you heard Ms. Williams talk about that, was really finding a schedule that complements our needs. A lot of times we're finding that there just isn't enough time in the day, that students are struggling, trying to take courses in the amount of time that they have, or helping students who are struggling really find support within the school schedule. Or meeting, you know, professionally with teachers, or having team meetings for students who are on IEPs or 504s, that there's just been a real logjam in terms of the time, and that we really need to do a needs assessment to figure out, is there a better way to dedicate and divide up the time during the school day? So that work is also beginning the school year. And then thirdly, in the same vein, really kind of taking a look at the graduation requirements, which is obviously your purview, but making some recommendations in terms of, are there some different ways as we look at surrounding schools, as we look at the colleges and career, in terms of college and career readiness, to make sure that what we're asking our students to really focus in on make the most sense long term as we're trying to prepare them. So we're engaging in discussion again with those different stakeholders, and we'll be coming to you with just some suggestions and recommendations. And then also kind of talking about the notion of rigor and the levels that we currently have. So we have CP, SCP, honors, and then in some cases AP. But really having a school-wide discussion around what rigor is and making sure that we're not just equating rigor across those levels with more work or with, you know, greater volume, but really asking ourselves, are we asking the differing levels of questions? Are we asking for different levels of assessments that still challenge kids at every level, but aren't bogging them down unnecessarily with just more work? And as we look at that, I think the issue around some of our mental health issues, our social emotional challenges, that's a big, you know, area that we're trying to probe a little bit more deeply and see if it is, well, kids can't take more AP courses, or is it more around the way that we use the time in terms of our assessments, our homework, our expectations, also our co-curricular activities, just making sure that we leave and no stone unturned in terms of the balance the kids have, the workload the kids have, but agreeing to what rigor is.
So one of the things that we discussed it in here, and maybe it was last spring or fall, I'm trying to remember when, but we talked about, and it still bothers me that we call strong college prep. I still think that, you know, that's a label. That doesn't need it. Where does that fit into that?
Yeah, so I think tying to that, as you can see around the levels, we want to really take a look at whether or not all those levels really make sense in getting kids ready. And in some cases, talking potentially around collapsing some of the levels. After a thoughtful look, a thoughtful conversation with the students, with the school community, with parents, also with colleges. In many cases, you know, our neighboring schools have, you know, one level or two level in addition to advanced placement. But what's been discussed early on, even in the thought of collapsing some of those levels, teachers are really interested in making sure they have the tools to be able to differentiate thoughtfully to kids who are coming with different levels of readiness, and so that we're not just kind of shooting for a nice ideal. It's kind of like we talked a moment ago about AP, challenging kids to rise that level, but also giving them the tools and the skills so that when they get there, they're not overburdened. But making sure that if we were to kind of collapse some of that, the teachers had that tool bag to be successful.
Yeah, I guess I'm not necessarily saying, I'm just talking, I mean, just someone will say, oh, you know, he or she is in college prep, they're not as smart as the person that's in. That's all. Not necessarily changing, the curriculum, but just changing the stigma.
Yeah, and I think some of that probably comes from, are we really providing the rigor at the CP level? Or is it starting to take on a notion that is less than kind of college readiness? And I think that's a part of having that school-wide rigor conversation so that we don't mistake. I've heard, for example, at the CP level, in some cases, maybe we don't give as much homework. We don't give any homework, and certainly that's not differentiating. We want to make sure we're still challenging kids and not setting them up to fail down the road, but also not overwhelming them, going over their heads.
I think I totally agree with your philosophy and the direction you're heading. I think differentiating instruction is not necessarily something secondary teachers are really familiar with. Many of them, even at recent graduates, it's more something I think, it's expected at the elementary level. Differentiated instruction is just a word that is, it's a practice that happens regularly. A day-to-day basis, sometimes as many as five different levels in a third grade class. So I think that could really lend itself to making a big difference in terms of, and I agree with, what Chuck had said about labeling students, and, I think too many, breaking them into too many different, to classifying them into like four or five as we have now, I don't think makes sense. I just think the instruction is really what needs to change, and not holding teachers in contempt or anything, or us studying they're not working hard. I just think it's something that they're not always familiar with.
No, I appreciate bringing that up, and that is something, again, as we have those recurring agenda items in our department head meeting around the DCAP, just being honest and being supportive around particularly that bullet on our DCAP, differentiating instruction, differentiating assessment. There is a range of skill, familiarity that requires some support. So I think we're trying to create a safe environment where, during our after-school time, but also in our during school collaborative time, the teachers can begin to kind of compare notes, learn from those who have some success around differentiating instruction. But the other thing I think, too, is being honest about those levels. I've myself taught in an environment in Boston where there were no levels. And that sounds all well and good too as an ideal, but sometimes the gap is so great between students' skill level that you just, it's very difficult to differentiate across such a big gap. And I think to have some levels with really intentionally looking to see, can we challenge those kids to bump to the next one as they go through high school, makes some sense too. So those are discussions that we'll be having this year around the level and the rigor.
I'm really interested that you're having this discussion about academic rigor, and it seems to tie in really well to the discussion of data. Because I think a deep dive into how are certain levels of students performing on standardized tests, be it the 10th grade MCAS, the SAT, how many are taking AP courses, I think there could be a lot of data-based decision-making around this. So
absolutely.
Really interesting.
I just wanted to build on that build on that and make sure that the data that we look at, when you look at the data from outside, whether it's other districts or you look at the data that's related to colleges, I think that it's the bar is very high. And we have to, there's a balance between the whole child and the social emotional and the wellness and making sure you know what's going on and rigor and expectation that's going to prepare them, you know, at a variety of different levels. So I'm not so sure that I'm so comfortable with the collapsing thing, but I think I'm very comfortable with we need to look at the rigor and the expectation and make sure that it's where it needs to be, because I don't know that the label, you have to call it something. It's going to have a name. It's how people see, what people see as the outcome of that and how students are participating in that, what they're getting out of it, that will make the conversation be, yeah, that's a really appropriate. Yeah, you'll be really well prepared for, you know, the set of colleges that level is designed to prepare for versus, you know, other types of dialogue that we don't want to hear. And then I was here when there was a program here that used to be called Focus, and it was, the kids were in this building and it was not, it was all the things that we've worked really hard over the last 20 or so years to change. So I think this is good in terms of, again, data-driven views and to make sure that we look at the data that's outside us.
Right. I mean, we want to make sure we keep the bar high no matter what the level is, no matter what the evolution became, if there were some changes to be made. But part of that, again, is calibrating assessments, making sure curriculum, we sort of identify what are the needs and those, the most important things, regardless of what the level is, so that doesn't become kind of a dumping ground.
Right.
The other thing that's come up is making sure that we're not using, you know, discipline, or not using the levels around behavior or discipline interventions. You have some very bright kids that may struggle with behavior and find themselves in a level inappropriately because we've used the level as an intervention, and that's another part of our discussion around rigor. So those are all things that we're kind of taking a look at in guidance, administration, and the PLCs.
Yes.
And I'd add just a clause, and very bright kids who might not perform well on tests.
Right.
So there might be alternative data that's not necessarily from a test result that would propel that or motivate that child or show that they're qualified to be in a different level, whatever.
Yeah. And again, so that right in, is in line with the DCAP conversation. If we saw a student struggling, and we tried different assessments so that we're not just sentencing a kid who has the ability but may struggle on tests. And then also we're kind of looking at beginning the work or resuming the work around our accreditation through the different superintendents initiatives, including Dr. Doherty. NEASC has really responded and realizes the amount of time, resources in terms of money and time of the staff. Having the system that once was for many years, including every teacher and wordsmithing at every standard and every subcommittee, I think they've now kind of realized they need to streamline that process so that they maintain the integrity of an accreditation process, but also not interfere with initiatives that are really important for different schools and districts. So Dr. Dory and I have met with the leadership from NEAS, and it sounds like they really have created a system that makes sense. So in the spring, early spring, we'll begin the first part, the first steps of that process. And what they've done, some of the key highlights of the changes, is they now are asking for essentially a steering committee to lead most of that work in looking at the standards, and they're also allowing some space to identify the standards that maybe a school has already made significant progress in that won't require the same level of analysis. And once NEASC has taken a look and agreed that the standard looks good, they'll have the district or the school really focus in on the other standards that would require the same process that we've seen in the past. And the vetting process remains the same, so it's never a steering committee driving all the decisions, but they're doing the legwork. And then you're coming back to your staff, certainly with the votes, with the conversations that are so important to that all-inclusive process. So it does seem like they've listened, they've heard, They want to be a part of changing what didn't make a whole lot of sense that taxed districts and schools. So we're excited about that step. Here.
What's the process? How long is it now? What's the length of there's a self-evaluation, I would assume you're still doing that, or?
Yeah, so it's now, it's extended to 4 years, so they're giving much more time to schools so that you can make a strong case without taxing the school's staff and resources to really pre-assess or predetermine with them those areas that are already look pretty good. And it sounds as though they mean it. It's not just lip service. And then in that second year, you're identifying the areas in your school improvement plan that you really want to focus in on and key in on, and they are taking a look to see how, based on your own goals, relative to their standards, the progress that you're making in that second year. And in the third year, they're really making recommendations to make those changes if there's a need for resources or changes in the schedule or changes in some of the courses. And then that fourth year, they're coming to visit to make sure that that's happened. So they've given, I think they've acknowledged it takes more time, but they want the school to really guide the process rather than it coming from on high, you know, from the standards. The integrity, they want to maintain the integrity of an independent eye, but they want the school to help guide them in terms of, well, what do we need? What is it that the school staff and the leadership thinks that the school needs? Got to provide the evidence in the same way, but I think they're giving a great deal of autonomy to schools to guide that process.
That's good. So, and then every 10 years, so it starts, the 10 years start after that fourth year?
I believe so.
Okay.
So when did we suspend doing, was that 2 years ago now? Or when we?
It was 2 years ago.
So
maybe 3 years ago.
Has there been any fallout from that?
No.
Why not just leave it? Let it go?
I think the biggest reason is that you do want to have a process for your school so that you can take a look at what you're doing and how you can make yourself better. So I think that's the reason why, and Adam and I have talked about this a lot, that you do want that reflection process that's done by an outside group to take a look at what you're doing compared to a set of standards, which they have also adjusted, that are aligned with the direction that we want to go. So that's the reason why we want to do this.
And how much does that cost?
We don't know. It's not going to be at the same level as the previous process because it's not as labor intensive.
Were you asking about, is there a cost? The cost, there's an internal cost, resource cost, and there's a fee.
Oh,
what were
you
asking? You
gotta pay the people that are assessing you.
I didn't know what you were asking, what that fee.
So just for clarity's sake, I don't think this has changed. You really haven't other neighboring educators coming in and looking at what you're doing. So they're being overseen by NEASC, their administrative leadership, and their standards, and they're taught, here's our standards. So I think it's really healthy to have, a opportunity to have people come in and assess what you're doing and look at it. And I think accreditation is really important, and I know it's very important in higher education. If you don't have the right accreditation in higher education,
totally different discussion.
True, but it's still a very important piece. I think you want to be able to say, we talked about admissions to different universities, colleges. You want to be able to say you have an accredited program, high school. I think so. I'm in favor of it as it is now, not so much the way it was before.
And then lastly, just improving our coordination of supports for our students who are having difficulty, whether it be academic, social, emotionally, and really key in on some of the teams and structures that we have. I've mentioned a few already. But we want to tighten up our student support team. For a long time, it's really fallen on our guidance counselors to be reactive as we look at students and their grades coming out or crises that come about. And it's really been them on their own. We've had the benefit last year in adding a general ed social worker to help just assist with some of the mental health needs, and that's been hugely helpful. But trying to be much more data-driven, f- focused in on where we prioritize our time and efforts around the process. So, and we'll get to the structures in a moment, but we've seen greater attendance from our classroom teachers, who are just so important in helping us to figure out what's working, what's not, with students who are having difficulty. So they are joining our guidance counselors and our administrators in trying to problem solve versus having one person try and solve it all on their own. And that's been, so far, a huge success. We talked a little bit about the DCAP. Again, that's been significant, and there's obviously a learning curve. This is our first year really trying to adhere to that and talk about areas that we need to develop more professionally or areas that we need to make sure we have consistency in terms of intervention. The other thing is that we have the two team chairs who are working with our assistant principals in a new, sort of a newly configured model. So our assistant principals are now grade level assistant principals. So Mr. McSweeney has the 9th and 11th grade, and he is working with Adam Blaustein, who's the team chair for 9th and 11th, which just lends itself to more regular conversation, the kids that they have, they share in common. And then Ms. Stephanie Lassise is our 10th and 12th grade team chair, and she's working with our 10th and 12th grade assistant principal, Laura Olson. And they just follow those kids throughout the grade levels, so they will remain with those kids for their 4 years. And the hope, obviously, is that they just have a greater understanding of, you know, the kids' needs and the different challenges. Also, just increasing the coordination communication around our special education programs. Just having, again, a team chair structure is really the strongest piece of that, working with the assistant principals, but just scheduling more frequent meetings. We're using a kind of a check-in and check-out procedure in some of those programs where attendance became such a huge area of concern, but really trying to work with a student who may have anxiety and may have struggles going into the general ed classroom on a block-to-block basis, on a day-to-day basis, and providing supports, whether it be coping strategies, whether it be assistance if a student is having a difficult day and needs to be out of the classroom for the day, for the block, but setting much more deliberate goals more frequently rather than it being, you know, every 4 weeks, every 5 weeks at the progress report time at the end of quarter. So that coordination has helped improve the progress of those students. We've also continue to expand our transition room for students who are hospitalized, either for social emotional issues or even physical ailments around concussions or other physical issues. And what we saw for a long time, both in the former school that I worked at and here, is that students in their reentry were really just starting to snowball. Their work was so much for them that in many cases, what was a medical issue turned into a social emotional issue. The anxiety that just would pile up around that work that needed to be completed. And so our transition room is staffed all day by one person, and she does a great job of working with the guidance counselors, the social workers, the classroom teachers, to just facilitate that work. And in some cases, the decision is made jointly to go to a VHS model where the attendance has just been such that really the best way to recreate the experience is online. Because the student just isn't ready to re-enter the class. And we're also looking at a Tier 2 support in the same room as a general ed learning center. So students that may be found ineligible for IEP or for 504, or just a kid who is having trouble after the SST team has met and tried different things, may need an extra dose of support in the transition room. And the transition room person is working with the school psychologist, really trying to teach explicit skills around study skills, time management, some of the executive functioning. And that's really in the early stages of development, but we're very hopeful that those will provide some of those greater supports that a student may need before, you know, needing additional supports in the form of 504 IEP.
What's the personnel in that transition room? Is that a certified teacher or is that...
No, so this year, Sam Pindara she was a paraeducator up in Chelmsford, is pursuing her master's degree in guidance counseling, and is aspiring to be a guidance counselor. So she is really working very closely with our guidance director, Ms. Lynn Williams, guidance counselors, and the assistant principals really almost as a tutor, who's facilitating that work, the makeup work, but then also in the case of the Learning Center, is working with the school psych, who's sitting down and kind of giving her different lessons that would be helpful around some of the executive functioning. So mm-hmm. bolsters that tutoring role with a little bit more, and our hope would be to expand that, depending on the need, depending on the success, with additional staffing. And then also looking at just continuing the time and the contact, as Ms. Williams had mentioned, with the guidance counselors, so that it's less reactive, but that students are better equipped in ninth grade with some of the study skills, some of the, kind of the career readiness skills, better understanding themselves with the hopes of heading off issues as they go along in the 4 years. So with the schedule change possibly, it would allow for some of the increase in time, guidance counselors working more closely with the grade level groups, and then also in the second half of the year on scheduling, we would envision a couple of weeks of 10-minute meetings with each student, as a follow-up to the work they've done at home and with their teachers around what next year will look like from a scheduling standpoint. Those 10-minute meetings are invaluable. It's amazing how much can be accomplished. Talking about electives, talking about career plans, just talking about school over 4 years. And certainly by senior year, as guidance counselors are scrambling to write those recommendations, they have a lot more to refer back to over the 4 years of growth. So just quickly, some of the structures to make these initiatives possible. The key one that I think we've seen some benefit already has been the reduction of staff duties. So the hall duty, the lunch duty, things that have tied up a lot of our staff's time during the day, and we've reduced that by 25%. So what we've done structurally is, for half of the year, the only duty that really has to exist is our study hall coverage. And so we've taken half of the staff, and they're really taking the lion's share of those study halls. And so for the first semester, they do have a duty. The second half of the staff does not have a duty and is instead either working on just their own professional work, looking at instruction, looking at assessment, working with their colleagues, or they're attending what we're calling our block-based collaborative groups. 2 days a cycle, that is centering around some of these bigger initiatives that we just discussed. So right now they're looking at the school values, how to operationalize those core values. The next one will be, the topic will be looking at the schedule and graduation requirements. And so they'll have that time built in during the day, and what's nice is it really is a rich interdisciplinary group of staff, across all departments, having discussions around school-wide issues. And then what we're doing is after school once a month, they're reporting out to one another as a staff. So the concern was, well, half the building is participating in these important conversations while the other half isn't hearing. That meeting once a month is allowing for folks to report out and have the entire staff weigh in on certainly important topics. At the halfway mark, it reverses. And so the staff that's been covering a study hall will now have that additional staff time and then also participate in those discussions.
Can you? So does the block base mean that, like, if teachers who have block B
yep.
open, mm-hmm. that those teachers can get together in some spot?
Correct.
And then block C, the teachers who have block C?
Yep.
Okay,
yep.
I just want to make sure that I have them.
Yep, and so the administrators are each, so we are taking up the other part of the work, we're in the halls, we're in the CAF, we're also facilitating those block-based discussions with guided questions so that,
mm-hmm.
There's some structure okay. to it. But for the most part, professionals have led that work pretty successfully so far and seem to enjoy it. Getting out of their department and working with their colleagues across the school.
Almost afraid to ask this question because you just sort of answered it, but how did you cut their staff duties by 25%? I mean, where did you find the resources to make that happen?
Yeah, coming from some different schools, I felt as though the behavior in this building really didn't warrant the type of manpower we were providing in the halls. It really just isn't the same level of truancy, discipline that you find in a lot of schools, to our kids' credit, to our staff credit. And what we were doing, I think, just contractually, was making sure everybody had, had time and was covering a duty. We have 6 or 7 teachers in the cafeteria, kind of standing in one area talking to one another. you know, the cafeteria was fine. And so, you know, having assistant principals and the principal in there gives us a chance to kind of interact with the kids, get to know the students. You know, and we, in many cases, we know the students across grade levels, beyond the classroom, and it's gone pretty well so far.
Can I just do a real quick follow-up?
Mm-hmm.
That sounds wonderful, and I appreciate that approach. I also really appreciate you and other administrators taking on some of the duties. It communicates a really important thing to teachers, which is what you're doing in terms of collaborating and educating our kids is really valuable.
Right.
And so for you to step in and say, we'll take some of this so you can do that, is a very powerful message to the staff about what we value. So I really appreciate it.
No, thank you.
I would like to echo exactly what Jean just said, too. It's very impressive. One question I did have, though, is study halls.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought study halls were no longer a part of, with the new ed reform in the state of Massachusetts, that study halls were not counted as learning time. And
mm-hmm.
is that, are we doing it differently?
Yeah, it's still directed study hall. We have a teacher in the room. Students are working. A lot of times they're in the library and they're doing work
mm-hmm.
related to school. But the guidance counselors, administrators, are looking at continuing to reduce the amount of time that students have outside of the classroom. And so some of that, I think, we're seeing is tying into our schedule, into our graduation requirements,
mm-hmm.
Into our number of levels. So there's just a real log jam in terms of what's available to students in every block.
Mm-hmm.
And at this time, there still are a decent
yeah.
number of study halls that exist, unfortunately. But we do think that a lot of those issues I just mentioned are part of why those study halls remain.
And would that be a time that guidance would bring students in? Like you said, you're meeting with them regularly now. Would that be useful in that capacity?
That is what we're using. The, that's when we're meeting with students. We first look to see who has a study hall and when, and we're
yeah.
doing our best to have it during that time.
So I think you can't almost get, you have to have like a minimum of 3 studies per cycle. There's like no, almost no way to get around that. I've tried really hard to not have study halls. And it's really tricky. So I think it really goes back to the time planning and what kind of goals you're trying to achieve with the students and what that graduation requirement looks like
mm-hmm.
and how we can think maybe differently about some requirements.
Yeah. It definitely seems to be a byproduct of, again, the graduation requirements, the number of levels, and the
yeah.
schedule you currently have.
Right, and labs, you know, you got to have labs
yep.
are important.
Yep.
They're really important. How do you structure them? But when you do that, there's a cost.
And a part of the needs assessment we'll do on the schedule is how do we build in lab time that may benefit other subject areas so that we're not just doing it in one place, creating that need for the, you know, the off period with the study hall.
Right.
I was just going to say, and I think with extended periods, now you almost takes the lab
yep.
sort of embedded into the regular schedule.
Yeah.
But I think a big part of the, you know, at least when I was here, was the rationale for studies were essentially just staffing. We didn't really have enough course offerings. That, I mean, I know it's increased greatly since I've been here, but we were lacking in a lot of different areas, which I know is not necessarily the case now, but I'm typical Reading. I don't think we're always have it lined up exactly the way we'd like to. So I understand why we're doing it. I just wanted to know how we were doing it.
Yeah. As I mentioned, the block-based collaborative groups meeting twice a cycle. Some other topics that we anticipate that will take place, and I think those good discussions across discipline. We mentioned the conversation on rigor, but also just things like the EdLine usage, which many folks have said, you know, is inconsistent at the high school. Homework, just kind of philosophically, what is our value around homework? The weights around grading, that's another conversation we've talked about. Should there be different grade level expectations, as an example, maybe by senior year, homework is weighted differently across the courses in senior year, getting them more ready for college where homework isn't graded. So just school-wide conversations like that, those block-based collaborative groups really lend themselves to discussions like that. And the other thing that we're adding is once a month we've allowed for teachers to identify areas of professional development that they'd like to learn from one another in. So we're calling that interest-based collaborative groups. So far, there's a list of about 8 different topics that teachers will sign up for once a month and hear from one another or ask for different resources to kind of facilitate that. One group has actually been the Google Classroom. We have a few teachers that are really experiencing great success around Google Classroom. And so, you know, they're benefiting from one another's practice once a month and hearing how can I use that in my classroom. So a lot of times before, teachers would hear this great idea but not have the time to kind of look into it. So this gives them a chance to explore that area a bit further from one another. I mentioned the after-school meeting as the kind of the share-out from the collaborative-based, the block-based collaborative time. This will also apply to interest-based collaborative time. So once a month, that sharing out as a school so that we all get a chance to hear the different practices, the different ideas that are happening. It's a nice way to celebrate each other's work as well. And also, we continue our work on our MTSS team. As I mentioned, a number of department heads, our school psych, our guidance director, special education team chair, continuing to look at not only the Tier 1 work, but continue to expand into Tier 2. Students who continue to struggle after interventions, okay, now we need to up the ante of support. What else are we going to offer? And one such example was that General Ed Learning Center. And then lastly, just a focused effort in planning with middle school in that transition. So our department heads, at this point, twice a year, will be joining their counterparts in the middle school and looking at the curriculum, looking at their assessments, talking about transition, what they're seeing at this level, what folks are experiencing challenges with at the middle level, just to increase that intentional planning. So we're hopeful that that will continue to expand this year. I mentioned to you already just the personalization, increasing that work around our house office model. One other detail I'd add is it's actually taking all the student affairs and making sure one assistant principal is overseeing that. So that's attendance, that's discipline, that's academics. And that way you have, as a parent, you know there's one person you're talking to about everything and making sure that is consistent as well. In terms of discipline and attendance procedure, just trying to look at things in more of a restorative justice approach. Certainly we're holding kids accountable. We're trying to find ways for students to take ownership and be reflective in just making bad choices, bad decisions. So our assistant principals are working together to balance both the discipline side of it, but also the lesson. And also we've added senior privileges, which is a means to try and incentivize good behavior, good academic performance, and good attendance. And so that's tied into the biggest one is our study halls. So if a senior has an A block study or a G block study, they are allowed to come late or to leave early with parent consent. So long as their attendance is good, their discipline is there's no discipline, and their grades are consistent. And so a lot of seniors are choosing to go on to their job after school or using that time, to work on their college essays. They're still in the building, but they're in the library. And so far, that's been received very well.
I just want to say that I think you've made some, I appreciate your leadership style. You've come in, you've looked at the way the school is being run. You've made some changes that I think are extremely positive, heading the school in a really good direction. I think you're doing a tremendous job. You've done some great things. Guidance is really, I think, transitioned, and developmental guidance process, I think, is critical. So I just want to kudos to you and your staff, and keep up the great work.
Great team at the high school, so it'll make it a lot easier.
And talking to students all appreciate the work you do as well. I think you're very well accepted. I think it was a great choice bringing you to this school.
That means a lot. I appreciate that.
Thank you, Gary.
Yeah. Ditto.
No pressure. So we have to keep it that way then.
Yeah.
Thank you.
If you start out getting A, you got to keep getting A,
Yes.
I'm complete non sequitur, although I'd like to reiterate the kudos to you and your team. I have a question. Back when I was on the council for the middle school, one of the questions that arose was about accessibility to the high school for those middle schoolers who are making decisions about what their next step would be, whether they would, excuse me, apply for acceptance in a private school or whether they would come to our schools here in Reading. And I was wondering if there is a process in place now that students and or their families can connect with the high school to try to make an informed decision. I think they'll probably choose our high school, but so that they can make an informed decision now. Is there a process in place?
So I mean, we have the two nights, the Future Freshman Night 1 and Future Freshman Night 2, so one academic and one around the co-curriculars. Certainly we welcome parents to come in and visit the high school. This year we're joining the middle school in their Challenge Day activities, so our guidance counselors and administrators are going to join. I think there's 4 days planned of the Challenge Day activities just to get to know the kids before that all begins. Before they begin their experience at the high school. But I think we're looking to continue to expand those connections and hopes that the kids will want to join us at the high school.
When, typically, what time of year are the Future Freshman Nights?
So that's a good question. It takes place currently in January. Last year was in February because of the snow, and then in June. But we have had discussions around should we push that back before the holidays in December, because I think that's when selection starts for the private schools and trying to compete better. So that is something we're looking at this year and haven't nailed down that decision yet. But would welcome input and feedback.
Well, just curious, I mean, so the private schools host an open house and they have their best in front of you and you walk in, and how can you not love that?
Yeah.
I mean, it almost seems like we shouldn't have to do that as part of the public school. But what about doing, because it really would give people the opportunity. I know you can call any time and get a tour.
Earlier in the year. Yeah,
but in the fall, do a Reading High School open house.
Yeah. I think it's a good idea. Again, it's one that we did talk about. There was some, I want to say pushback, there was some, I think, discussion around how many students really are leaving the high school, and does it warrant that type of an activity or not. So we're kind of looking at the data to see.
Do we have that data?
Less
like,
than,
is it increasing?
Less than 20, probably.
Yeah, that's the numbers were less than.
But has it been on a steady incline?
No.
No?
No. It stayed about the same last several years.
I think the other piece of that, though, that I think is important, is students that are trying to, in the middle school, make a decision about the high school or vocational. And I think that's where I would really like to make sure that we're reaching out to those students and those families, because those are students that are staying, with the public school but are making, a significant decision. And so looking at, the timing of that dialogue and discussion and making sure that we're really supporting those students and those families and getting them the information. So I think, the timing of what we do in terms of introducing parents and students to the high school is something that, I think we need to look at and make sure that it's at least early enough to support students that are trying to possibly make a vocational school decision.
Yeah.
And if it can be in front of some of the privates, great. If not, then it's not. But I really want to make sure that we're considering that.
Yeah, I did come from a school where we did it in the fall. I can't say with any level of certainty if it had a greater impact, because that was the only time, we did it in comparison.
Right.
But it seemed to go pretty well. The kids all visited the high school during the day, and we had one teacher per department and a presenting activities in the facility, which was a nice chance for kids to see it. So it's definitely an ongoing discussion, so any feedback or suggestions is welcome.
There's a third group of students. I'm thinking about this idea. So you've got the kids who might be considering a private school. You've got the kids who might be considering a vocational school. Then you've got the really engaged families who know they're going to go to Reading Memorial High School, but might really enjoy. It could really set them up for a successful transition.
Yeah.
They become really psyched about coming here. So it could have some intangible benefits to school culture. So I think there are potentially a lot of audiences for it.
Absolutely. And then lastly, a couple of things in that after school time, having a group of teachers who will continue to work on positive behavioral intervention work, the PBIS work that we've begun at the district level. and exploring ways to implement some of the concepts around positive intervention at the high school level. And so that work has not yet begun, but we're looking to identify a group of teachers from each department who will do that, look into that work and ways to expand. And then lastly, believe it or not, the informal department lunches. Last year we went away from that. We scheduled in such a way in hopes of having teachers go across the building and eat lunch with one another. And folks expressed that they really enjoyed that informal time working with their colleagues and planning. And so we were a little bit more intentional around bringing the department lunches back. So you basically have wings within the building who are sending their students to lunch, and those professionals get a chance to see one another and talk about their practice. Thank you very much, everyone.
Can we do the two field trips next?
Sure.
So in case there's any questions for Adam.
Move to approve the Reading Memorial High School Model United Nations Club field trip to attend the Harvard Model United Nations Conference in January.
Is there a second?
Second.
Did you want to present on that? Or?
No, I just, if there were specific questions,
oh.
I did meet with Mrs. Fedeli on both field trips and went through the whole process with her.
Any questions? I was in favor. Did you have a question?
I sort of did. The conferences, I love the idea of the Model UN, and I love the opportunity the students have to stay with their peers from other places. Have you run into requests or challenges in terms of it's in Boston? So students that might want to keep a commitment in Reading and then go back, or is that an issue?
Not in the first year that I was here, there were not. Kids have come back just raving about their experience and, you know, continuing that global consciousness that I think we do a good job of promoting here.
Thank you.
Yeah.
All those in favor of the motion? 6-0.
Mr. Chair, move to approve the Reading Memorial High School Model United Nations Club field trip to attend the Boston University Model UN Conference in February.
Second. Any questions? Discussion? Yes.
I just had a question. Which hotel are they actually staying at? The Park Plaza or the, I don't want to put you on the spot. Okay. It seemed like it was being held at one of the hotels and they were staying at the other, and I was unclear on that.
It's what it says in the application is the hotel.
Okay. So it's
Sheridan?
Yeah.
The Sheridan. Okay.
Yep.
Thank you.
All those in favor? 6-0. Thank you. Before we jump into the other stuff, I forgot that there was any public input. Now everyone's like, yes, I apologize for that.
Not a problem.
Can you, do you mind coming?
Sure, what would you like me?
Right, with the microphone.
All right, you want me to sit or stand?
Sure,
or?
Whatever you're comfortable.
My name is Brian O'Neill. I live in town, Hanscom Ave, and I have two children in middle school. The only reason that I've came tonight is I know you're looking at the curriculum for next year programs, and I'm kind of glad that I sat through that last presentation because I think this is a great option for to present tonight. I have been in contact by email only with Dr. Dari here, officially met, but working in Essex County, I've had the chance to interact with some of the other school systems, and I thought something that would be great for the Reading Public Schools would be the Junior ROTC program, which Reading does not currently have. It's a free program funded by the government, absolutely no cost to this town of Reading at all, or any of the other communities that it's in. They provide an instructor that's paid for with those funds. Field trips are paid for with those funds. There's no out-of-pocket expenses at all for the town of Reading. After following that, with Ms. Williams just looking for extracurricular activities for kids going to college, there's some of these kids do not fit into, you know, the sports or this. My sons, we've tried hockey. Thank God we don't do that anymore at $5,000 and 5 o'clock in the morning. So we're off of that. We've done soccer. We've done lacrosse. We've done Boy Scouts. We've done music lessons. We've done Lego robotics. We've done a lot of the things, but they haven't really found their passion. And my son has been online looking at the ROTC. I specifically looked at the Marine Corps one because that's what Beverly had and that's what Gloucester have. I have a coworker that's in the Gloucester. She had a daughter that's on an IEP, and she was kind of closed, and she went to Gloucester, and she blossomed in the ROTC program. It brought out all sorts of things. You know, I was looking at some of the other things. They were talking about the staff duty. Here's a free staff person to help work the cars. I was just involved with the Medal of Honor project that was in Boston, and because Beverly had an ROTC, they had a Black Hawk helicopter come in, land on the school, and the Medal of Honor recipients come in and address the whole school to class, which was phenomenal. I just thought it would be something great for discipline. It gives kids some, they wear their uniforms to school on certain days. I saw the kids walking around, and they did have unbelievable discipline. They listened to the teachers, and it's not necessary that they push people towards the military at all. It kind of gives them discipline and structure. I think my friend from Gloucester said that nobody went in the military afterwards, but she said it just opened up everything. She said the kids got a free trip this year. They went to Parris Island, South Carolina, where the Marine Corps trains, for a week for free. Transportation, food, everything was free, paid for by the government. So I thought it would be just something that the school committee should know about, that there is programs out there that do offer something.
So we have exchanged a lot of emails. I have done some research into this. There is actually a cost to it. The cost is space. And we need to dedicate at least a minimum of 2 classrooms and additional storage for their material. And they called it guns and ammunition, but I'm sure there's other things as well. So I have not talked to someone directly about this. Unfortunately, as you know, we have space issues at the high school. And if that's a deal breaker, it's not something at this point that we can dedicate space to. But we are not closing the door on it. I think it ties into all the other things that Mr. Barker is talking about in redesigning the schedule. And it's something certainly we can look into in addition to this. But if there is a space requirement, which in the application it was pretty clear that you needed to dedicate this space, and it needed to be a locked area that could only be accessed by the commander and whoever is going to be teaching the class, that would be difficult to do right now, given our space issues.
Yes?
I suppose but I'd just look up more information if I wanted, but I don't know, maybe you could just send us what you looked at, John.
There's a whole application process. I'll be really happy.
Just so that we can, know, just see that, just sort of interested in the program. I know Beverly's program came into place, I think, in the 50s. I know the person who pushed to get it in Beverly. So I'd just be, I don't know that much about it, myself, but.
I looked at, the same thing. The only thing is I talked to the regional director who handles all of New England, and he said without the application process at least being submitted, nothing can happen at all. So just because you submit the application doesn't mean necessarily
right.
It happens. It's just if you submit the application, you can start to get a program. But if there's no app, they can't even do anything until the application has been submitted.
I mean, I thank you for coming here with this. It's something that clearly, I hadn't thought that we weren't doing, that we should really, assuming we can meet all the requirements, it's certainly something, and especially in the world we live in today, that
right. I appreciate it. I walked to school every day with my sons. You know, we would get out in the Birch Meadow every day. We'd walk by the school, and we'd see the Reading Memorial School with all the symbols up in the thing, and it seems like such a program that we should have, considering that we have it on the outside of our school, and we don't have such a program. just think it would be a benefit.
Yes.
I think she was first, but then I'll go second.
Have we ever looked into this before in the past?
No, when Mr. O'Neill brought it to my attention, I started researching it. I've had conversations with Mr. Barker about it. And then when I saw the space issues, the space requirements, that's as far as I've taken it right now. Honestly, we just haven't had the opportunity to pursue it.
No, but I just, like, mean, like, in the past 10 or 12 years, this has never come up before?
No.
No?
No, it has not.
Okay. I think it's interesting. I do know someone that benefited from it, my cousin's child. And she did actually go back into the military. But it was a wonderful experience for her, and it gave her great guidance and structure and led her onto a very good path. I think it would be a shame, given the fact that I know space is a cost, but if this is something that we would really like to explore, it would be a shame that we couldn't do it for lack of space when everything else is funded. I think it's interesting.
In all fairness to Dr. Daugherty, that I did talk to the instructor when I was at Beverly, and he said that they can work around certain issues. It's not stringent, they say. It's kind of a best case scenario, and you know, nobody ever gets the full, you know, dimensional. I'm sure not every school is built for that, and it's so.
So okay, yeah.
Could you say a little more about guns and ammunition?
This is. I am just taking this straight from the application, and again, I've not had the opportunity to, with Mr. Barker, to pursue this further.
Right.
So
I was just wondering what that means.
Into it more, and don't forget, we still have all of these other things that Mr. Barker is working on, that this can dovetail very nicely, but I think it's premature at this point to have that conversation.
Yeah, the guns and ammunition part is they have ceremonial guns that they use for the color guard. They go on drills, and they compete against other schools with ROTCs. Lynn has a fantastic program as well. It's competed across the country and comes in number one quite often. So they have if anybody's ever seen the silent drill team or the Cully changing of the guard, they do similar things, and they have, you know, ceremonial weapons. So it's, you know, they perform at swearing-ins. They do parades in town. They do all the civic events too. So it parlays into all that as well.
Yeah, I'm familiar with the Beverly program. I know the principal quite well, and several teachers up there, and they do hold it in high regard. I do think it's something we should be looking into. I don't necessarily think it's something we'd implement immediately, but I think it's worth looking at, particularly in light of the schedule work that Adam is anticipating to be done this year. And I do think, you know, would, you know, broaden the opportunities for our students, and you know, it might work very well for you know, a core group of students, and I think it's, and it seems to me, to be honest, if this, you know, regarding the space, if there's, you know, the opportunity to accommodate it without necessarily, you know, dedicating space, but it does seem like if there's something we really want here, we're able to find the space. So I think, you know, it's worth investigating.
And trying to keep some of those parents in district might be a little bonus to somebody to come in and say, ooh, they want to do this and stay here, as opposed to go to a private school or something else. It might be an attractive option.
It's a military school.
So as I go by Essex Aggie every day, I see them on November 14th is their day that you can come in to campus and tour. So it would be definitely something, if you had it early and my kid came in here and he saw this, that he would, I'm not going anywhere else. So it just might be a draw, just being a parent.
Thanks.
Yes.
I know that the way we operate here is to engage our teachers also in decisions that will impact their school. So I would assume that when we get to a place where we're seriously considering this, that we would also involve the teachers in this decision, I would think, in terms of including a program like this.
I think I would need to learn more about the program before we would even decide the direction that we could go with it.
Yes.
So I, you know, lots of comments made here, and I just, you know, I think the space issue, I just want to say it took us 2 years to find the space for the robotics team. So this, it sounds, sometimes you can talk about it and say, well, is the space an excuse? But I think we have to just really recognize that there are real hurdles there. And not just for you know, talking about a new program, but we're gonna probably be talking about, you know, a variety of things as we get into the next year. And we heard talk about other AP classes and trying to offer other AP classes. And again, every time we want to do something, it takes space. And I just want to say we've been sort of crushing the stone a little bit already. It did take us 2 years to get a dedicated space for that robotics.
I just appreciate the fact that Mr. O'Neill came here with this. We are not even close to to the point where we're talking about space. I think we need to continue to have this discussion.
Right.
And I don't think Dr. Daugherty's there yet where we haven't met with anybody yet.
Mm-hmm.
So
no,
that's
and
all you're asking for us
yeah.
to do.
Just,
that's
right.
What
I'm
just
making
so,
it aware
yeah.
is
and
another
knowing,
program
yeah.
that's out there with that's kind of free other than space.
And
yeah.
knowing that the high school's been doing this work, you heard it tonight.
Yeah.
That's why I have not pursued it any further, because I think it's all going to have to be connected in one thing. You can't just say we're going to do this program when you've got all of these other things happening.
Right.
It's got to be a connected process, and it is going to be tied into the schedule. And if the schedule doesn't change for next year, then this isn't something that can be easily integrated. You know, budget is going to play into this,
but you're getting ahead.
No, but that's my point. That's what I'm saying. I haven't pursued it any further because I know this has been going on in the background. So I have the information, and once the time comes, we will look into it further. Mr. Bark is aware of it. I've talked to him. I've been sharing. You know, we've had a few emails back and forth, Mr. O'Neill and I. So,
and I'm sorry I didn't have public input early. Maybe he could have talked to it if after hearing you speak at the beginning of the meeting. I apologize.
Not a problem. It's just it was a good segue. It was a good presentation. So I'm glad to sit through it.
Thank you.
I just do think it's important to look at what other schools are doing at this point in time too, to just get a.
I'm not disagreeing with that.
Okay.
There's a lot going on at the high school right now.
Absolutely.
To add, and it's not even this, it's add anything else, I think is going to complicate what they're trying to do right now.
Yeah, I don't think it would be that complicated, to be honest. I think just talking to Sean Gallagher, the principal at Beverly High School, will give you a little bit of an idea what it's like. And, you know, I don't think you have to investigate it that much more in detail, but is it a positive? And some of the principles that have run it.
We will investigate it when the time is appropriate.
Okay.
I was just going to say that we did make a promise at the beginning of the year to not start a lot of new initiatives this year, and that
We sat here and asked the principal to have more open houses. I mean, that flies in the face of what you just said. So.
Timing.
But I think we need to respect it, and when the timing's right, that's when it should come up.
I think it was a great presentation from Mr. Bakker, and I think your point, Dr. Daugherty, was really good. This is just one more thing to add into the mix. As we're talking about the schedule, as we're talking about what else we want to do, they're really big conversations. This is something that should be in that discussion.
Sure, and you talked about is positive behavior. There's nothing more positive than, you know, somebody that's been in the military, retired, and walks in and gives you a present that kids aspire to be, or to, you know, a good role model in the school. You know, another one is always positive, I think. Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
You want to do the district governance discussion now?
Sure. You want me to?
Yes.
Jump in on that? So you all remember we met on a Saturday morning several weeks back in workshop, and one of the products, the work products, after a lot, I can't even find it in my packet, a lot of back and forth and wordsmithing, was an operating protocol. And I think, you know, it's worth mentioning, it was really good to have Dorothy Presser from the MASC here to kind of guide our discussion and guide our work. But she talked a lot about, you know, best practices, and I think there was a lot of agreement that we're a very highly functioning school committee, and that we started from a real place of strength. So I think all this really does is codifies mostly what we're already doing. But instead of it being implicit, and this is just how we operate, and when somebody is newly elected to school committee, they kind of have to figure out the ropes on their own. This puts a document together and say, here's how we conduct our business, and here's why we do it. So it's in the packet. The committee obviously spent a great deal of time going back and forth. This reflects, I believe, all of the edits and changes we made that day. And so it is up for a vote. So I suppose with that, I'll make a motion so we can open up for discussion. Move to approve the revised school committee operating protocol. Second.
Second. Discussion.
I think it's extremely well written. I think it's a good representation of our day, our Saturday, and I really don't have the change to submit. Sorry.
Thank you.
I agree.
I actually have a question, and I apologize because I was meaning to call you in advance, and we just couldn't. 3 hours with a broken computer just took away my day. One of the lines that we have under the agenda is, and I hadn't read enough before our last meeting to think the way I am now about it. It says, school committee meetings are business meetings held in public, not public meetings. And I just think that bears a little discussion and explanation. Because in my reading, I think what I've been finding, it's very important that we not only talk about how important the involvement of our community is, but also how valued their input is. And I don't think that this is meant to devalue the contribution of those who would attend our meetings. And I just want to make sure that that statement does not convey that message, because we are only the quality school system we are because of all the people that are involved and the feedback that we get and the willingness to collaborate with us and think about things. And so,
if I could, as you may recall, we talked a lot about public input and how to clarify, I agree with you 100%, the incredible importance of engaging the community. And actually, in my update, I probably should have mentioned our next session with the MASC governance program is scheduled for Saturday, November 31st. And on the discussion is, I believe on the agenda, is going to be a discussion of public input. So I think we'll be kind of diving into that a little bit on Saturday. So I think it's a really valid point.
Yeah.
Can I just say that I understand the point, but I really support this statement. And this is probably one of the statements that was in the protocol document that we did like 10 years ago. So I think I would hope that nobody would read that and think that that's a discouraging statement. It's just a fact. This is a policy body. These are our meetings. We're here to do work that we need to do, and we're here to listen to the public. And it's so that's the type of meeting it is. At times we have a public hearing, that's a little bit different format. When we have a public hearing, it's all about absolutely listening, you know, to the public on that particular subject. So I would hope that no one reads anything into that that's not intended, but that statement was in the original the protocol document that we had.
Well,
10 years
and
ago.
We're held to certain laws as well,
right.
We have to make decisions that don't necessarily allow for public participation.
Right. So I appreciate all the work that I know Jean did an enormous amount of work specifically, so I really appreciate that.
Yes, thank you. I had another question.
Yes.
We had discussed during our retreat that email communication, I think that's a really important point to punch, actually, that how we operate, there's a protocol, so communication goes through the chair and the chair replies. Sometimes, though, people reach out to individual school committee members, and we actually discuss two ways that the communication can come back, all of which includes the chair and superintendent in the conversation, but sometimes the chair might reply, but sometimes the person that's approached might communicate with the chair and figure out an appropriate response, just so the chair is always informed, and a response might come from a school committee member, but it will have gone through the chair. And so I was just, that's not reflected in this, in the verbiage in here.
Yeah.
I think under communication in the very first sentence, I think that's covered. In order to promote the consistency of communication, only the school committee chair and or his or her designee shall have the authority to speak for the school committee to public bodies, the media, or individuals who reach out. So I believe it's covered in that statement.
So the person, the person that was written to would be the designee.
Only if the chair says so.
If the chair says
so. If the chair says, you know what, that person reached out to you, I hear what you're saying, would you please respond? You're being designated by the chair to respond.
I feel very comfortable with that. Thank you.
Nice job, Jean.
That leads us into the discussion on the consent agenda. Did you want to start that, John?
Sure. So we did a little research on consent agendas and how it works. Here's some possible guidelines on how you would move forward a consent agenda. Essentially, the purpose of it is to streamline your meeting for routine procedural decisions and decisions that are likely not to be controversial. So some examples could be minutes, final approval of proposals, policies, reports, field trip approvals, donation approvals, appointments, staff appointments, reports provided for information only, correspondence requiring no action. So the process that would work, and this is done in several different types of board meetings, is you'd still get the full agenda. You'd still get all of the information. That would not change. The public would still get all of that information. But there would be an amount that would be considered the consent agenda. And then the chairperson and the superintendent determine ahead of time whether an item belongs on a consent agenda and prepares that list. So that is then, all of it is part of the regular packet. And then what happens is that at the beginning of the meeting, the chair asks, is there any of the items that want that need to be removed? And then those would be voted on separately. Mm-hmm. Okay. But the things that are not removed would be all approved in one vote.
Something that I really liked about the protocols you sent out, Dr. Doherty, if I'm reading them correctly, any member of the committee can pull something from the consent
Correct.
Agenda. So if I, as an individual member, have a concern or an issue with one particular thing, all I have to do is say I'd like to remove it, and it's removed.
Correct.
You don't have to have a majority vote for that.
Correct.
Or debate Correct. Over it. Or
exactly. Correct. So I think that really protects that every committee member has the full opportunity to discuss and debate anything
Always.
They want to.
And then the chair can decide whether to take that matter up right immediately after.
And I had a question about the consent agenda. I actually really like the fact that we publicly thank our donors, because without their contribution towards our education here in Reading, we couldn't have the caliber education that we have. I like that the field trips and the donations would be in a consent agenda format. My question is whether that can still be read out loud succinctly, but so that a formal thank you is said. And I understand that, and I love that the donors would be written. We discussed including the donors on Edline, where the parents groups that work so hard to raise the money to pay for their additional staffing and so many other improvements. But I like that we have a chance to acknowledge them at our school committee meetings. And so I'm wondering if, even though we won't be discussing these items, we'll be voting for them en masse, I'm wondering if we could succinctly mention what it is we're voting on verbally at the meeting. And maybe I would be comfortable with the chair deciding something doesn't need to be included in the description. So everything doesn't have to be that way, but I really feel like it's great for people to know about the field trips that are going on and the donations that have been made to our school system.
So maybe something like we vote on a aggregate donation amount of $10,000, and that comes from, you know, and then list all the organizations.
Would it be listed in the item? Wouldn't the items be have the details? So like, there's no sample here, but I would imagine that, so if item three is donations, it's gonna, is it just gonna say donations, or would it say?
You would have the complete packet that you normally get now.
Okay, so it would all.
And we would list in the consent agenda what you're voting on, that one vote.
Right.
Because you would need to know if someone wants to take that off.
Right, so let's say there were three donations, and for some reason I had a problem with one of them. It would be number, it would be, maybe it's item number six, and I can say, can we take that off? And nobody's going to argue we take it off. And then the chair would decide, are we going to address it right at that point in the meeting, mm-hmm. or whatever. So the detail is going to be there already.
That's correct.
Right.
So it.
The detail's not going away.
So it's just a matter of, is somebody just reading through those items, don't we send letters out?
We do.
We send letters out to all of the donors. So I guess it's a matter of maybe those items, just to read the detail of the field trip approval. So if there's three field trips, you're just saying the approvals include X, Y, and Z field trip.
Well, there's field trips and donations separate.
Right. But I'm just saying, in terms of, I really like this a lot, and I don't want to overcomplicate it, so I'm just saying if they're detailed out, you just, as you say, the consent agenda, you just read, you know, field trip to the UN, field trip to the New York City, the Opera, field trip to Brindle Pond, donation from Women's League, donation, you know.
That's what I just said.
Oh, okay.
We just list all the donors.
Okay.
And $1 amount and one vote.
Okay.
Right?
Correct.
I totally support it, and I want to see us do it. I don't want to make it more complicated than it is, because I think this is great.
I think we should give it a shot.
So we'll try it for the next meeting? Okay. Right.
Do we need to vote on it? I don't think
no.
so.
We don't need to vote.
No.
So this weekend, everybody should come see Mary Poppins, this weekend or next weekend, on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. And with sports this week, volleyball, boys soccer, football, and the girls swim team are all in the tournament. And the girls swim team had an undefeated season, and volleyball and football also with swim are Middlesex League champs. Also, last weekend there was a marching band competition, and our marching band placed fifth, and quarter one closes tomorrow. That's it.
Good report. Thank you.
Thank you.
Committee reports?
I don't know.
Yes.
Who was first?
Does.
I just wanted to report that the RACASA event with Dr. Hill was this
Thursday.
The attendance certainly was less than I would have hoped for. The talk was outstanding, and really, I think there was actually a lot of really good questions, Q&A during the Q&A, and just really appreciate, you know, how important it is to, I think, raise the awareness that marijuana, and the points that I think, and maybe John could add, but the points that he really tried to drive home was that marijuana is addictive. 17% of people, young people under the age of 25 who use marijuana will become addictive. That's 9% for adults. And that There are ways to treat it, but because people don't necessarily believe that it's addictive, most people are not getting treated until there is some other complicated abuse problem, whether that's alcohol or some other drug. And I think that for me, it really ties in well with the YRBS survey results that we had just heard. And I'm still just so troubled after hearing him talk that that we as parents need to be communicating to our underage teenagers whose brains are growing that this is very wrong. It's very wrong. Alcohol, tobacco, drugs, marijuana, they're wrong. And if we're not communicating that, we're doing our kids, I think, a disservice. The difference in the, you know, he went through a lot of data. He did present a lot of data. My sons were arguing with me about one of the charts afterwards. I was very irritated that they didn't ask the question in the meeting. One of my college-age sons actually came home and attended. But I think that the another key piece of data is really the strength difference in the THC. So for us as parents who may have walked these halls 30 years ago when the back parking lot could have smelled like that, the world's most favorite weed, it was a different weed than there is now. So the difference is it's like 5% to 7% THC when we were young, and now it's in the teens to 30 perhaps. So it was really, really, I thought, informative discussion. And he does talk a lot. He talks to student groups at different high schools. So I don't know if that's something that maybe the RACASA board will also talk a little bit more mm-hmm. about, and, you know, find out more about how those discussions are set up in various schools and how the student groups are accessed. But I think it would be... He seemed very relatable would be very relatable to young people also. So it was excellent.
Was that by any chance covered by CTV?
Yes, I believe my nephew was there too because he was taping. So I'm very excited because there was a good web contingent, contingent there. So I know that I saw my nephew taping, so pretty sure it was covered. And I had just one other short item.
Sure.
The cross-country team did run at the league meet today, boys and girls. I don't think that those teams have won any championships this year. I'm not sure, but they ran really hard and they ran well. So not one of the sports that maybe was in the lead this year, but they had it was a perfect day for any competition today.
I have a couple of reports. The first one is the Human Relations Advisory Committee met last week, and we are preparing to present to the selectmen tomorrow night at 8:30. We're looking forward to talking to them about ways to communicate with our community about events that we're planning, how to get the word out. We are also planning to have a tree at the Festival of Trees, so please come support the Reading Education Foundation on December 4th and 5th. Our next meeting is December 3rd, and please write down the date for the Martin Luther King Day celebration, which is actually on that Monday. It's a breakfast, and we have been talking about the theme. It really promises to be a great event on January 18th. And the second thing that I want to defer to Mrs. Wilson, but I just wanted to say that I attended as liaison the CPAC, the Parents Advisory Special Education Parent Advisory Committee meeting, the first one last week, and I left there reveling in both the energy and the excitement and the knowledge of a lot of the parents that were there, and that they're very interested in taking on the responsibilities of being an advisory group and communicating in positive ways with both Mrs. Wilson and the school committee. And I thought that was very exciting. And I know that they're already planning their next meeting, and I don't want to, I think Mrs. Wilson will continue that, talking about that.
So is there, I'm sorry,
question about is I know in prior years they've had trouble getting in a board to get, is that in place?
That's the same issue we have. So we had, okay. Last year, the first meeting we had similar attendance. We had about 25 parents in attendance, which was great. I presented the findings of the Walker report. People were very interested, had lots of great questions about where we're going in regards to special education. There are a group of parents who are interested in taking on more of that leadership role, so they've actually coordinated and communicated with me about another meeting on November 18th to try to bring people together to do some planning. So my hope is that people will turn out. That's really, they've had some struggles because the way their bylaws were written and how they get a quorum. And so we were discussing that they don't need to reinvent the wheel. There are a lot of operating CPACs, and they could look at their bylaws, mm-hmm. and there's a lot of great resources out there for them, but that it really has to be the parents, that it's not my group, that it's their group. So I think they heard that message and are really trying to.
Well, that's good news. Sounds like progress.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So, and there were some great, very positive parents present, and so it was nice. And nice to see some different faces as well for me. So,
and I can I say
so,
one?
Sorry.
It was really amazing to once again be listening to all that you, Mrs. Wilson, do for our schools with your job description and how you address the needs of not just our special education children, our gen education, our whole schools benefit from your expertise and your devotion. And it came out loud and clear, and I thought that the parents were very receptive. They learned a lot about all that you're doing, and the honesty of the Walker Report, I think, was also very appreciated.
Mm-hmm.
And your presentation was spot on. So thank you. I had one more thing.
Sure.
So I was privileged actually to go to the J.W. Killam school, they call it a school meeting, about trustworthiness that was put on by the MTSS, multiple tiered student support team, last week. And it was a very inspiring experience to see the teachers explaining to the kids and engaging the kids in the lesson about trustworthiness. The teachers actually were very explicit about why they do what they do with the children, and they engaged the students in being role models, and also even talked about why they might be giving an example, why they might be giving golden tickets to get a message across about what the behavior matrix is, about what is appropriate behaviors, and then why those golden tickets will not always be available. They will not always get golden tickets for doing the right thing, for making the right choices, because it's not just about what we do for the prize. It's about what we do to fill buckets. It's what we do because it contributes to our community and helps our peers and helps other people in our environment. And the message came through very strong, and they used, I loved the quote, when life throws you a curveball, hit it out of the park. So it's not going to be easy. You're going to need grit, which Killam has and other schools have presented to us about before. So I just wanted to mention I really enjoyed being there, and the end of the assembly was a very energetic whole school doing a dance that they do during their phys ed classes. So three classes got up on the stage and led this cardio workout that was done to music, loud music, that all of the children were involved in. And it was very fun to see the energy. And they went from the high energy here to a positive timed exit from the room, which was quite remarkable, and lots of positive feedback, steering the children into a positive exit when their energy was high so they could control it. And I think all the children really, from what I could see, they got the message and were really engaged, and it was very exciting to be able to be there and watch that. So thank you.
Thank you.
I do. I just wanted to give you an update on some staffing components. So we had a vacancy in our district-wide school psychologist at the elementary level. That position has been filled, and we're very excited about that addition. She will be starting on Thursday. Her name is Florence Johnson, and she will be working out of Killam, but working with our elementary and with the Rise Preschool. I have hired a new administrative assistant who will be coming on board Wednesday, Anne Marie Foley, which is very exciting, joining the student services office. And then we have also hired a new ELL teacher, and I don't have her name offhand, but I wanted to let you know that that position has now been filled, and she will be starting November 16th. It's a district-wide position, similar to our other ELL position, but we have a great need. Our numbers of ELL students have increased dramatically, and so we're kind of in a pinch right now, and this is going to really help support the 1.5 teachers that we do have district-wide. So those are the three updates I have.
Thank you. I had two things. And I will send this to you. The Foundation Budget Review Commission submitted their final report today, and they had a press conference this morning on it. So it gives a series of recommendations on what increases should happen and changes to the Chapter 70 formula. The one takeaway that, from a global perspective, is that it would cost an additional $430 million to fully fund the recommendations that were put forward today by the commission. So immediately the Speaker of the House did make a comment about how difficult that would be to do in 1 year, and it's something that may have to be phased in, or it's something that may not be feasible at all. He had not read the report when he made those comments, but I will send that to you so that you have that information. But it does show how underfunded public education is when it comes to the changes that have been made since 1993, when the original formula mm-hmm. was put together. Mm-hmm. And the big ones are special education, healthcare. They mentioned in-district special education as well. ELL came up, mm-hmm. Early childhood education. These are all things that have changed since 1993 that have have not been considered in the current formula. And then the other thing I wanted to mention is that probably next Monday or Tuesday, the PARC results are going to be made public. So like we did with the MCAS results this year, we will be sending out, when we know the day they're going to be public, to the community, the results with some written explanation on that. They don't know yet if it's going to be Monday or Tuesday. It's when they're able to set up a press conference, the state. So we'll know more information hopefully by the end of the week. Yes.
Thank you. That won't be individual student scores, just district-wide.
No, it's just school and district scores. Individual scores are going to be sent to us the week of the 23rd, which is Thanksgiving week, right? That's Thanksgiving
yes,
week.
It is.
Monday
so
night.
So it may take until December to get those mailed home to parents. My understanding too is the accountability ratings are not going to come out until December.
Thank you.
We will be doing a presentation for the committee on the 23rd on the park.
Uh-huh.
And schools will be doing their presentations after Thanksgiving.
Oh, the individual schools at the schools.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Did you have?
I just wanted to say we have a town meeting just on coming up. Right, in the town meeting. Our next meeting is not until
the
23rd, right? Because we have town meeting is currently scheduled the 9th, 12th, 16th, and 19th.
It'll probably be two.
Be two nights.
Two nights.
Yeah, two nights. Maybe three, but probably two. And I'll be giving the state of the schools next Monday.
Okay.
Next Monday or the...
Isn't that the 9th?
No.
Yeah.
The 9th.
Next
no,
Monday,
ninth.
Yeah.
Oh, shoot.
Wow. Any other discussion? Motion?
Motion.
Yeah.
discussion, donations?
Donations.
Mr. Chair, move to accept a donation in the amount of $1,400 from the Reading Cooperative Bank Charitable Foundation to be used to support the RMHS A World of Difference program.
Is there a second?
A second.
Second, any discussion? Yes.
I just wanted to quickly say a huge thank you. The Reading Cooperative Bank, actually, this is one part of a three-year commitment to paying half of the registration fees for the World of Difference program, and it enables the high school to have this program. It's hugely appreciated. They also, on top of that, provide water for their events and publicity. So truly are doing a great deed, because what AWOD accomplishes trickles out to the whole community. Thank you.
All those in favor? 6-0.
Mr. Chair, move to accept a donation in the amount of $1,000 from Northern Bank to be used to support the Challenge Day program.
Is there a second?
Second.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? 6-0.
And Mr. Chair, move to accept a donation in the amount of $1,000 from the Friends of Reading Soccer to be used to support a coaching assistant for the fall 2015 season.
Second.
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 Any discussion?
I'll just say thank you for these incredibly generous donations. We really are very lucky.
All those in favor? 6-0.
Minutes.
We have minutes.
Mr. Chair, move to, this is right around when I'm thinking the consent agenda.
Yeah.
Mr. Chair, move to approve the open session minutes dated.
Especially when there's a football game.
Yeah, exactly. This is around, I think, when the public is turning off. Move to approve the open session minutes dated September 26th, 2015.
I second that.
Second. Any discussion? All those in favor? 6-0.
Move to approve the open session minutes dated October 5th, 2015.
Second.
Second. Discussion. Vote. 6-0.
Move to approve the open session minutes dated October 19th, 2015.
Second.
Second.
Second. Any discussion? Okay. 6-0. Any other business?
No. Move to adjourn.
Second. All those in favor? 6-0.